Hello, welcome to Central Washington University's film program end of the year showcase. This is night number two, and in a second I'll tell you a little bit about what we're going to show, and the program is also available in the notes on this YouTube page. But first I want to say a very special thank you, because this has been a really challenging year. So the first people I want to thank are our students for hanging in there through difficult circumstances, challenges with equipment, challenges with being able to be together to shoot, you know, some of you being remote the whole time. So thank you so much for the amazing work that you did. And I also want to thank our program director, Scott Robinson, and our really incredible faculty, Michael Caldwell, Justin Daring, Asad Faruqi, Todd Mayatani, and Jason Tuholke. They are really outstanding individuals that helped make this all happen. I also want to thank Alex Rapass, who's the president of Wildcat Films this quarter, and he is running this live stream. It was a ton of work to put together. So Alex, thank you so much for all of that. So we have this really great lineup of films tonight. You will see some documentaries. You will see some of our films that fell into the miscellaneous category, including a mystery film that I know what it is and you don't. So stay tuned for that. And then after that will come our Production 6 films, which are essentially capstone films that our seniors have been working on pretty much all year. So these tend to be their most ambitious films of their career with us. So it's really great to be able to share them with you. Please join in and be part of our comments. Those will be running throughout, and it's really great to just know that you're there and see what you think and help applaud the work of these really outstanding filmmakers. Oh, after that, we will have we will move into a Zoom meeting, which will be broadcast, and we'll have our awards ceremony. And if you want to be in the Zoom meeting, family, friends, alumni, you are welcome, and feel free to contact me or get the link from your student who might have that for you, and we would love to see you in there. So that's it, and on with the show.
Between the 1980s and the early 2000s, film lovers only had one way to enjoy movies outside of the theaters: video stores.
Welcome to Blockbuster Video!
Today, these stores have nearly all died out and become a thing of the past. But there's one place that has emerged through all of the industry turmoil. Behind me here in North Seattle is Scarecrow Video, the world's largest video library. We're looking for a couple titles today, so let's hop on in and see what we find. Scarecrow Video is a movie lover mecca that boasts the world's largest video library.
We have movies from the entire history of film, from every country in the world. That's a record of so much more than just movies. And to keep that available to everybody is really what's important.
When Scarecrow Video was first founded in 1988, with only 800 or so VHS tapes in their collection to rent, they had no idea that they would become a world-famous bastion for physical media.
We accumulate from any place we can get as much as we can afford to bring in. It's always been our passion to grow this catalog and keep it out there for everybody.
I mean, honestly, it's completionism. It's desire to be more completist than necessarily to be successful monetarily.
From 800 titles, the store grew and grew. Today, over 30 years later, Scarecrow owns an unparalleled publicly accessible catalog of 140,000 titles.
A lot of places count individual episodes of a TV show. We don't do that. A season is a title. So it's a lot of stuff. We're the biggest in the world.
With a catalog so extensive, if you lined up all of their cases like dominoes down I-5 starting at the store, the last case would fall at SeaTac Airport.
space has always been a problem, and building out shelves and finding nooks and crannies for us to pack the movies into is always going to be a problem. There's blaxploitation, vroom, that's for car chases, bikers, rednecks, truckers, there's jungle movies, there's Viking movies.
We have a vampire section, Christploitation, sexploitation, silent films.
A whole war section that's actually organized by conflict and not by title. So like all the Civil War movies are in the same spot.
Rock musicals, classic sci-fi, Bigfoot movies.
Bang, which is just for our generics for action movies.
Movies about movies.
The whole store is sort of broken down by that because we just have so much that it's impossible to put them into big, big sections. You're lost. It's already easy enough to get lost around here.
Like a twisting and winding labyrinth, the aisles can feel like they're rearranging themselves as you move through them. Now, my hunt for three currently unstreamable movies begins.
Coppola. Where's Coppola? See you. No? Must be on the other side. Should have. Oh, I missed it.
Not only do we have this big catalog, but we have people here that know how to use it and can point you in the right direction, help you find what you need, maybe find something that you didn't know you wanted.
Being surrounded by the collection and being able to dive into it and really snoop through it and then talk about movies with people, talk about movies with the people you're helping out find them, like all that, it pretty much requires you to be excited about it.
So we're in the psychotronics section here at Scarecrow, and we're looking for supposedly one of the worst movies ever made. It should be right here. There we go. Manos. And you can get it in DVD or Blu-ray. Perfect.
In high school, I'd drive all the time with my friends from West Seattle to the U District to drink coffee and listen to music at Cafe Racer. After the shows in the evenings, we'd walk just down the block to browse the endless shelves of Scarecrow and pick out titles that we'd never heard of. A block in the other direction is the Seven Gables Theater, a historic 1920s Seattle landmark that hosted art house film showings in its prime. This is a street with deep-rooted local history and a passionate film culture. Part of what set Scarecrow apart from the big chain stores in the 1990s and 2000s was its commitment to foreign, cult, and otherwise very rare titles instead of focusing solely on big Hollywood releases.
Beneath the Dome. Got it. Two for two.
And it still is that way, only instead of standing out as unique against Blockbuster, they stand out against Netflix. Over the years, Scarecrow Video survived many tumultuous periods as video stores faded to obscurity. Family Video, Movie Gallery, Hollywood Video, and the biggest chain of them all, Blockbuster, began dropping like flies once a newfangled service entered the market, online streaming.
The streaming services has done a really good job of selling you on the idea that they have all of it, but really they don't. Between Netflix and Hulu and Amazon, you're talking about 40,000 titles total, so we have like three times what you can stream anywhere. Yeah, how many times have you gone on social media and your friend is like, this is expiring from Criterion Channel tomorrow, or this is going off Netflix next week, you gotta watch it right now. It's absurd. Nothing ever expires at Scarecrow.
These massive shifts in the ways that people began watching movies spelled disaster for the store.
I can tell you that it was probably pretty bad. People didn't come for a while and then they stopped coming. The biggest fear was that, you know, if the store were to close, this collection would be bought up, maybe sold off to collectors, that would be able to restrict access to it, break it up into pieces, and that's just not something that we're happy with at all.
Cafe Racer has since shuttered its location, and Seven Gables burnt to the ground just a few weeks ago. These places don't always last. But here in the middle, Scarecrow still stands. In 2014, the store transitioned from a for-profit business into a 501c3 nonprofit.
The mission is, as a nonprofit, to keep this massive collection available and accessible to anyone. We were really afraid not just for our jobs, but for the collection. We wanted to keep it intact. We started a Kickstarter to raise the funds to basically begin operating the store as a nonprofit for that first couple of years. The previous owners generously donated the entire collection.
The business has been saved, at least for the time being. As one of the last video stores surviving into the 2020s, Scarecrow Video is wholly unique in that way alone. But beyond that, Scarecrow is unique for its incredible selection of over 100,000 titles spanning 127 years of cinema history from nearly every country on the planet. It's one of the only places you can find a classic like The Godfather next to schlock like Dementia 13, Citizen Kane next to The Trial, The Empire Strikes Back next to R2-D2 Beneath the Dome.
I can't believe I've been here almost 20 years, you know? It's kind of all a blur. Like, I was your age when I started working here, and now I'm in my 40s, and I'm still going to church every day, you know? That's what I love about this place. This is my second home. It's my church. It's where I do the thing that has given my life purpose, exploring this catalog. I'm a professional appreciator.
Perhaps there's something greater than convenience when it comes to film. History, knowledge, humanities, and physicality can't be found through streaming. Picking up a disc and popping it in the player makes all the difference, transporting you from a film library in a rainy Seattle neighborhood to worlds and lands far away, no matter how obscure. As a teenage hangout, as a piece of cinema history, as a Seattle icon, and as an irreplaceable resource for film lovers everywhere, here's hoping to many, many more years of The Crow Still Flying.
Tonight, we are at Swauk Prairie Cemetery. Tonight, we walk with the dead. Whether peaceful or restless, there will be spirits afoot.
An incredible experience over there. It was amazing.
That was beautiful.
What happened?
Well, I used the divining rods to see if there was anybody here, and it went over and it pointed at Ryan. And so Laura went over and stood by Ryan, and the meter just started going off.
We got there early to walk around and just kind of like get some extra footage for the documentary. And in the darkness, I saw one tombstone probably that just kind of drew me in.
And I stumbled on to the grave of a baby.
And that was a little freaky. You know, like the first tombstone I look at is one for a baby that died over 100 years ago. And we met up with the pit crew, and we were following around one of their psychics. And I turn around, and the baby tombstone was right behind me. It was like, in this big old cemetery, how did I encounter this twice?
Oh, there's a lot going on in this lady.
Interesting.
Okay, I have a little pendulum right here. And this pendulum will turn to the right to say yes and left to say no. Is there someone here with us? Yes.
You know, their sensors start picking up activity and they walk over and, like, all their stuff is just kind of freaking out, like their pendulum's getting activity in there. So it was crazy.
Right by you.
Oh,
there you are.
There you
hello.
Were you hanging out with the boys?
Sorry
That's
if
not
I'm
a bad thing.
Standing on you.
We ended up moving on, and I encountered probably 4 other graves of children, and they all had a bunch of activity at them.
It's got a lamb on top. I'll bet it's a child.
Oh, look at that. We can see you.
They like
you. Again.
Wowza.
Oh. It was like I was some sort of ghost baby magnet.
If you need energy, you can take it right from the EMF meter that I'm holding in my hand.
Ryan just got pointed out again.
Okay. You must be an empath, huh?
I'm not sure what that is.
Emotionally connected to people, where you can feel their energy and feel like, you know, dogs like you, kids like you, that kind of thing.
I see.
Mm-hmm.
That I was in tune with the emotions of the spirits, and it was a interesting thing.
Ryan on his throne after being proclaimed a baby whisperer.
Thank you. Okay.
I guess I'm an empath, you know? Changed my title bubble from skeptic to skeptic empath.
I haven't been haunted by any ghost babies, so I'm pretty sure they all stayed at the cemetery.
Welcome to
Charles and Samuel, are you here with us?
We had become aware of the story of the father and son who were lynched in 1895 here in Ellensburg. We went to the location, and we actually had more than we knew that we caught.
I came to know about the pit crew through Facebook. There had been a post that was asking for information about haunted sites throughout Kittitas County. So I started looking at what people were suggesting for the pit crew to take a look at, or what was being considered as haunted, just to compare to what we had as known data and what others had suggested. And one, of course, is the Benson lynching.
Do they have anyone here with us?
Yeah, we sure do.
Would you like to communicate?
To my knowledge, the group is basically a group of enthusiastic individuals who have gotten together to find out about paranormal experiences. They're also looking into not only what the site is, but what the history of the location is. So, you know, tying not just what occurred to just the site, but also finding out what actually occurred to possibly make that location haunted.
Okay, so we're all watching the instruments, and the mediums are doing their medium thing, and one of the group had what's called a ghost box, and it shuffles through all of the band on FM radio, and it will pick up voices from the other side if there's somebody there to talk.
Samuel, are you with us?
And she discovered after the hunt that she had contact from both the father and the son lynched for killing a couple of local business owners.
I slowed it down.
I heard I am Sam.
So the Vincents were two individuals, a father and son. The father was named Samuel, and the son was a 29-year-old man named Charles, and they lived here in Ellensburg.
Hey, Charles! Oh, Charles. I bet you're proud of yourself being a wife beater and a drunk. You want to come talk to me and tell me something different?
In the late 1800s, Sam and Charles Vincent were known as lushes in the area, as well as women beaters, so they're not real friendly with women. And they got in a fight in the bar and ended up in death. Somebody got shot, somebody got stabbed. The owners of the bar specifically.
These individuals mean quite a lot to the city of Ellensburg. They show a darker side to Ellensburg's past, in what can happen when citizens are riled and when the justice system is broken and they decide to take that justice into their own hands in right or wrong that they feel should be done. People are very willing to believe that with a tragic incident, it will trap a spirit, you know, or the memory of that event at that location. The more violent the incident, the more likely it is that some residual is in that area.
We caught on the ghost box, "I like to hang," or "would you like to hang?" Which was very coincidental to just say it's just some random station that was picked up by the spirit box.
Folks will come to us telling us that they've felt a presence, a dark energy or aura that occurs with that intersection.
I know that all three of us that are the gifteds had experiences. We all had visions, we saw things, heard things, and experienced things, and a lot of it did not get caught on camera.
Well, there's multiple things that have happened in that spot. It's a crossroads, and what actually happens in areas like that is where the most traumatic energy happens. You have car crashes, you have shootings, you have stabbings, you have lynching, people, you know, jogging, dying of a heart attack. That's a thing.
I think somebody died of a stroke. I don't know. I've never had one, so I'm not entirely sure what this feeling is.
I picked up on different things. I sensed a child, a little girl, and we encountered a shadow person there.
And then the shadow person kept trying to, like, bait people to come across the street to see him, and every single time a car was coming.
A friend of mine lives just on the other side of the block from there, and I asked him about the shadow person because he walks his dog that way, and he said, no, I have never noticed anything like that. But I do hear a little girl laughing sometimes, and I was like, what?
You want to know, truthfully, is something haunted, you know, or you want to know, because there's a dark story, there's a dark legend that occurred with the location, is there something really there? People swear that a creepy old house has to be haunted, because it creaks, it pops, it does weird noises. So why not? Get a crew in there, prove it. Fact or fiction, you know. Is it really haunted? Who knows? I mean, my sister loves ghost stories and loves ghost adventures and has her own collection of tools. The recorders and the like, and don't ask me what they are, I can't tell you. But from the historical stance, I can see how people believe that locations can be haunted, because there really are some dark stories.
When I first started here, I would call this the pound. 25 years ago, pets had 10 days. There were no vaccinations, there was nothing. It didn't matter what color they were, what breed they were, what size they were, they had 10 days. If they weren't adopted in 10 days, they were euthanized.
There's always been that perception that a humane society is a dog pound. And you see that with Hollywood, and you see animal control out there with giant nets, and that's really not how it works. But everybody sees it as just a cage.
I hear a lot of people, when I tell them I volunteer at the Yakima Humane Society, they always want to know if it's a kill shelter.
We still have that belief in a lot of our old-timers. They're there 3 days and then they kill them, and that's so not true anymore. We get to consider ourselves a no kill. We do not euthanize for space. We do not euthanize an animal because it's ill.
Everybody now in the world of rescue is trying to be seen as a rescue or a humane society because we're no kill facilities. A pet comes in here to be adopted. It isn't a place where they go to get off the streets and their life ends. It's a place where their life begins. It changes for the better. But ideally, their placement is a home. They're companion animals. So while we don't want to see them confined, we maintain their health and safety as best as anybody could. And it is definitely a safe location for them. But We want them in a home. We want them in a loving home.
It could always be better. There's always room for improvement.
It was much smaller. Kennel space was cramped. They had these types of kennels, these ones on wheels for some of the smaller dogs and cats. And those were just kind of moved in spaces where they could fit. And now there's designated areas where those animals are. The kennels are built in, they're safer, they're easier to clean, and they're easier for the animals to be able to move around and have more space.
I think what keeps me driven is that, you know, every year it gets better and better and better for the animals. It has truly become an adoption center. It is, we keep them as comfortable as we can. They have beds, they have toys. You know, they're cared for the whole time we're here. And we've made some pretty awesome strides in the last few years.
It's completely black. It's hot, obviously. You know, when you're breathing air, when you know you can't if you take off your mask, that's pretty scary. But again, you know, we've got a hose line, we're in there, we're never alone. You know, we have a very good accountability system. So we just depend on each other.
You know, when you first start off as a paramedic or a firefighter, you know, you think you're going to go out there and you're going to, you know, change the world. And I think everybody thinks that that's the way it's going to be. And what you got to remember is that some people hurt themselves so badly or they are so sick that you're not going to be able to save them. And unfortunately for us, you know, you always learn never quit, never quit, never quit. And then you have something that happens and it doesn't work out the way you wanted it to, and there's a bad outcome. And then you kind of carry that with you. We had some calls that just kind of lingered and stuck on you, and you just couldn't wash it off.
We try to be tough, but you know, when we see a hurt child, it just kills us all. We had to do CPR on an 18-month-old kid, a little boy, that did not survive. And in that week particular, when we see a code 99 call where CPR is in progress, I think out of 5 days we did CPR on somebody, 4 out of those 5 days. And when the 18-month-old passed away, it was like, seriously, don't talk to me right now. I don't want to cry. So it gets hard. Those are probably the worst one.
I have several calls that I routinely play through my head, so yeah. Yeah, and it's just the sadness of them all. You know, in one case was a small child that was out having fun with his dad, playing around and on a motorcycle, it was one of those things where nothing we did was enough.
Everybody knew him as being the guy that they could go to. He really wanted to make his family, his girls, his dad, his sisters, his brothers proud. And he felt like the fire service was probably the best way for him to do that. He always wanted to be the hero for everyone. When the accident was first reported, the union put it out on their Facebook page. The news picked up on it. He was hailed as a hero.
Talking about the death of firefighter and...
Thank you for your service. Thank you for your dedication. Oh my gosh, it was just an outpouring from the community.
The department itself pulled together, you know, and helped with the funeral, and had a big, you know, made kind of a celebration of it for him.
So we had different jurisdictions that were joining into this procession. It was amazing to see. And then when we got into town, you know, the ladder trucks from all the different jurisdictions surrounding us, they had the flags dropped down. We had, the streets were lined with people that had parked to show their respect. It was such an outpouring. It makes me emotional just thinking about it right now. It was incredible. But then after his memorial service when I had announced that he committed suicide. There was silence. Nobody knew what had happened. I had called them from, we were vacationing in Rockaway Beach, and he jumped off the balcony. He was life flighted to Legacy Emanuel Hospital. And I had called these guys and just said, look, there was an accident. He's in the hospital. We'll talk at a later point.
I think there was a lot of disbelief at first, we thought it was an accident. We thought, it had to be an accident and all that. And then later on, I think there was a lot of, most of us, I think many of us, asked ourselves, did we miss something?
There was a fire with two kids that burned up in their house, and he worked with the dad. So it was kind of a daily reminder of what happened, because he would see the dad, he knew the dad, worked with the dad. It wasn't until 2019 that he finally admitted that he was an alcoholic. It got to the point where I had seen episodes of anger and aggression that were coming out during his alcohol when he was really drunk. And then from there, I started seeing it while he was sober. And that was a new point for me, and it kind of scared me. I knew something was off. He finally was accepted into a program through the International Association of Firefighters. He was really excited. He thought that this was it. He was finally going to get the help he needed. COVID hit in March. He was due to leave March 26th of 2020. We got a phone call on the 13th, I believe it was, that his spot had been canceled. He just kind of lost it at that point. When I came here to tell his shift mates and said it was suicide, it was like the air had sucked out of the room and everybody just kind of just changed the subject. Honestly, there's no other way to describe it. Just change the subject. And at that point, I just said, we're not going to ignore this. I'm going to use the platform that I have, which is going to be his memorial service. I knew that there would be multiple people from multiple jurisdictions that were going to be here. It was going to be, live on Facebook, so I knew I had an audience. Afterwards, I had so many spouses that stopped me at the funeral service to say, I've watched my husband go through this. Not sleeping at night, the tossing and turning, the aggression. I've experienced this. Thank you. Thank you. And I know that I've gotten personal stories from our guys, even, and some of the guys from outside of this department that have said, I've sought out counseling because of what you said. I've gotten on medications because of what you said.
So it's amazing what we put ourselves in, the risks that we take, and, we're not made of armor.
That was a big question for me after Andrew died, was who's there to save them? And I kind of made it a mission to bring this topic to light. Just, if we keep silent, who's gonna save these guys? Thank you.
creating the Raga guitar. Creating the Raga guitar helped me learn that we're so comfortable in our own spot of the world. You know, if you live in a small town and you go to a big city, you're like, oh, this is so different, it's so weird. But it's still our own culture, and it's comfortable in so many different ways that we're just not aware of until you go somewhere else where absolutely everything is different. And when you're put into that situation, you get more of a sense of what's going on around the globe outside of yourself. And I try to carry that awareness that the world is really bigger than our little bubble. My name's Josh Humphrey, and I am a luthier. The story I tell with music is my sister, who's 2 years older, was learning piano, and I would like lay underneath the piano while she played and listen. And I just loved the sound of it, and it just seemed like a logic that made sense to me. I tried piano lessons and I hated it and I cried. But when I was 14, I discovered the guitar. I had played like trombone in school band, but guitar was it for me. And I got into indie rock and Seattle. I was in Seattle area, so grunge music, Nirvana, punk rock. And that was it for me. Took it up a notch in my senior year of high school, and I built a solid mahogany acoustic guitar, double cutaway. It was kind of a copy of the Gibson Melody Maker. When my friend told me he was going to college for music, I was like, you can go to college for music? Sign me up. I studied theory and composition. And yeah, it was just fantastic. I loved every minute of it. I was writing a lot of music for a string quartet, and I was learning classical guitar. And after I graduated, I got into a master's program at Eugene, where I did a Master of Intermedia Music Technology. And it was basically electronic and acoustic music combined. I was like, this is my future, I'm gonna do this. But it was such an intense period, it kind of burnt me out. So that's actually what drove me to want to go back into the shop and start building acoustic guitars. My friend that was at Central and got me to come out there for a music program, he was really into Indian music, he loved it. And so after he graduated, he wanted to go on a trip to India, and he lived there for 2 years. And he's like, why don't you come with me? We'll travel around India for 2 months, and then I'll stay, you go back home. And I was like, sure, India, great. Was that eye-opening, you know, completely different culture. It feels like being on a different planet. The language is different, the customs are different, the way people walk and talk and move is different, the way you stand in line is different. Just absolutely everything is different from the ground up. And that's a really, really eye-opening and valuable experience for, I think, any human. I fell in love with the Indian culture, and I got into Indian music myself. The music of India is very much based on melody. Where Western music, we use a lot of chords, and a chord is three or more notes at the same time. The melody in India is given such elaborate development and treatment. There's just way more scales and way more combinations given than your typical sort of Western music. After a few years of building guitars, my friend Brandon, who studies and teaches Indian music, he found out that I was planning to move back up to Washington. He said, hey, we should design a guitar for playing Indian music. There are some guitars for Hindustani music that you lay down flat on your lap and you play it differently, but there's none designed to play like a normal guitar. So he proposed the idea, and I went to work designing it. Yeah, built it, basically, just designed and built it. So the concept is based on the idea of taking a normal guitar and then adding extra strings that are called sympathetic strings. This string vibrates, and it causes these to vibrate like almost like an echo or a reverb. So these are really important. And then the next set is these, which are called shikari strings. There's a Hindu temple that's like a mile from where I grew up, and they have classrooms there, and they're very, very kind people, and they let me use one of the rooms to teach. I have about 27 or 28 students in Sammamish, and they're all learning Indian music. All my life I've loved music, and I've loved building things, and I never knew how that would all work out as I pursued those interests. In some ways it feels like a self-fulfilling prophecy of your interests and your what you work hard at coming together. And in a way that's completely unexpected, which I think has a beauty to it. And it's definitely not easy. Pursuing music and pursuing teaching are not the most lucrative careers, but just by staying true to what you're passionate about and by working hard at it, more importantly, working hard at it, you can find a path that maybe isn't obvious or you didn't even think existed. But just by being open to the possibility of inventing an instrument, learning how to play it, and then teaching it also is sort of a dream come true, really. And you know, if that's all I do for the rest of my life is learn to play and learn to teach and learn to build, keep learning to build Raga guitars better and better, I'd be happy.
FM, on long wave, on digital radio and online. This is BBC Radio 4.
Thank you. There's no place like home.
Wake up, honey.
There's no place like home. There's no place like home. There's no place.
Dorothy, Dorothy, dear. It's Aunt Em, darling.
Oh, Annie Em, it's you.
Yes, darling.
Hello there. Anybody home? I just dropped by because I heard the little girl got caught in the big... Well, she seems all right now.
Yeah, she got quite a bump on the head. We kind of thought there for a minute she was going to leave us.
Oh.
But I did leave you, Uncle Henry. That's just the trouble. And I tried to get back for days and days.
There, there, lie quiet now. You just had a bad dream.
Sure. Remember me?
Your old pal, Hunk?
Oh.
Me? Hickory?
You couldn't forget my face, could you?
But it wasn't a dream. It was a place. And you, and you, and you, and you were there.
Oh, sure.
But you couldn't have been, could you?
Well, we dream lots of silly things when we...
No, Aunt Em. This was a real, truly live place. And I remember that some of it wasn't very nice, but most of it was beautiful. But just the same, all I kept saying to everybody was, I want to go home. And they sent me home. Doesn't anybody believe me?
Of course we believe you, Dorothy.
Oh, but anyway, Toto, we're home. Home. And this is my room. And you're all here. And I'm not going to leave here ever, ever again. Because I love you all. And, oh, Annie M., there's no place like home.
Interest in this position, but this time we're not. Jesus.
Hey!
Hey!
How's work?
Not too bad. Erin's still not showing up, so I get to handle her cases until she's back.
Damn, I'm sorry.
It's okay. What's wrong?
I didn't get the position.
Oh, babe. Come here. So sorry.
Yeah.
Hey, I'm here now. What can I do?
Nothing. I'm just tired.
Why don't I cook tonight? You can have the night off.
I got it. It's okay.
You sure?
Yeah.
Okay.
Why don't you go upstairs and get changed? Shouldn't take too long.
Sounds good. How's your day?
It's fine.
So Aaron comes back to work tomorrow, so no more dealing with her shit. It's gonna be okay. I promise.
I am okay. Alright? Nothing's wrong. I'll be done in a sec.
Okay.
Okay. Hey, Katie, can you hear me?
Hear you. Hi, James.
Hi.
How are you?
Good, good. How are you today?
My day's going pretty good. So what would you like me to do for you?
Well, I want you to strip for me. And I want you to play with yourself, but I want you to act like you just got home from work. You've been thinking and wanting me all day.
I can do that for you.
Cool.
Yeah, okay, so let me go get that started for you. You like what I'm doing? Now you can keep this when we're done.
You good?
Yeah.
Well, how was your day?
It's fine. Why are you home so late?
Erin took me out for coffee. Turns out she's not so shitty after all.
Well.
Is dinner ready? Frozen pizza then.
Can I get for you?
Yeah, do the drip coffee, 12 ounce.
Sure thing, I'll ring you up down here. You're disgusting. Hey, where have you been? Bad interview?
I fucked up, Zoe.
You fucked up. What happened? Hey. What's going on? Are you okay? Hey. I thought you were shaking.
It's a bad interview.
It's okay. It's okay. Hey.
So, most of you struggled pretty hard on this assignment. I can't blame you. You've probably never seen a tree before. Folks, quick reminder, lab fees are due next week.
Hello? Hey, I'm not gonna hurt you. I'm not gonna hurt you. So you painted those? Beautiful. Okay. Well, I'll leave the paints in case you want to finish.
Excuse me.
Did you paint that?
I haven't seen anything like this in a very long time.
Thank you.
Could I take it off your hands? I'll pay well.
What do you mean?
35 parcels? How about 50? Does that sound fair?
Yeah, that sounds great.
Good. Oh, how creative.
Huh?
The little Hune that you have here. Not a lot of people know about these little creatures anymore.
Rakna Hune, prophesied to appear in times of great distress or disorder. Maintaining balance in the world will always be their true nature.
You don't have to do this. What the fuck do you want from me?
Mary, I'm in rough shape. I don't think my mind can take it anymore.
So you're gonna make me do this alone?
I think maybe we should both hold off.
I'm not quitting, Jude. It helps me relax.
It's not good for you
either. You don't have a fucking clue what's good for me! So why don't you just quit your high and mighty fucking act and be supportive? Mixer.
be strong tonight. Juice by tonight, I swear to fucking God.
Get in the ditch. Get in the ditch.
Look clear, sir.
Get in the ditch, Mary!
wasn't a nightmare, Porter. It was sleep paralysis. I was awake.
What are you implying, that these are real? Okay, so the house is old, but it's not haunted.
But you called.
What about me calling?
You called, and then when the paralysis ended, my phone was still ringing. Same time.
Oh, okay, but those things happen in dreams as well, so...
No, you... I don't know how else to explain this to you so you can understand. I just... I'm stuck in some alternate reality. I mean, I can still see and hear everything around me. I'm just stuck.
I hear you. You're under a lot of stress right now, but I need you to relax, okay? It's a lot quieter than the city, I know, but it is safer. You remember when you had these nightmares last?
Yeah, when we found out about Lila.
Right, and you were anxious, worried then too. Now once you're settled in, these dreams are gonna go away, I promise you.
Franklin, and Yakima counties. The report estimates if the virus keeps spreading, cases from Eastern Washington could reach numbers close to the recent peak in King County, despite the population difference. To stay safe and slow the spread by social distancing. More updates coming up at the end of the hour. In other news, a warning tonight from Redmond Police to keep an eye out for a prowler. Officers say they've taken a few calls over the past month of a man lurking around properties in the Willows neighborhood. Take a look at this chilling image taken just the other night from a house in Idlewood. The homeowner spotted this tall, masked figure hiding in their backyard. Luckily, their dog seemed to scare him off. But at this time, authorities are unclear as to what this man's motives might be, and they are now warning city residents to stay vigilant and lock up day and night.
How far away is Redmond from Sammamish?
It is 7.2 miles to get to Redmond from Sammamish.
checked around the house. Everything's fine. Lila's fine. I'm sorry I yelled at you earlier. Shit has gotten so out of hand. Hey.
I love you.
I love you too.
I've been squatching 13 years now, just about. I've met a few others. None of them are really quite as devoted as me. Check this. Ape Man premium string. This stuff is like 100 times tensile strength. He's not getting away this time.
I've been squatching with Hugo a few times, but this is gonna be my first all-nighter, so I'm pretty excited. And you know, it's really strengthened our relationship. We kinda have to be there for each other, you know?
What's this?
Mom's snacks.
Hey, Ma. Can we come in? Pretty please. Thank you.
Jesus. Ma, did you ever clean out this closet?
Here's some complex proof that I was, in fact, an all-star.
What the hell did you bring these people for?
Because I wanted to show them what Dad looked like.
Yeah,
I thought I could have gone pro, but glass, started fishing, you know how it is.
Why is there so much wrapping paper in here?
Hey! Keep your greasy mitts off my tax return.
Oh, hey. Found it.
Oh my gosh. Oh, it's you!
Yeah, oh.
Is that a pickle?
Yeah, sure is. I think I have some in my car.
Oh, is that him?
Yeah, he taught me how to be a man that day.
Oh, wow.
Let's see what else we got.
Jesus. Mom.
I can't help my shaky hands.
It's okay.
April 12th, 2004. I came home from school, went to go play in the backyard, and I came home to this door, wide open, lock forced. Snagged on this nail. Over here, multiple bipedal footprints, bigger than my head. Strange? Yeah. Perplexing? To some. A coincidence? Absolutely not. My dad loved this place. The quiet, the tranquility. That's how Bigfoot got his scent. No way he lets another alpha male stomp through his forest and get away with it. No sorry. First we'll sweep through the interior, make a camp, establish a perimeter. And then we'll lure that hairy SOB right into my trap.
Woo! 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 Woo!
Woo!
Woo!
Hey, Hugo. Hugo?
Huh?
Did you bring any spray?
Yeah, you bet.
What the hell is that?
Bigfoot pheromones?
Why does it smell like piss? Some.
Don't worry. My dad taught me a trick just for situations like this. Refreshing, mm-hmm. Isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Look at this. Look at this girth! This is definitely a sign we're in his territory now. Okay. Yeah, I think this is a perfect base camp. Tell you what, why don't you go set up? I'm gonna go scout the perimeter.
Hey Hugo, can you do me a favor? Like, find a creek, something to wash it off?
Sure thing. I think we'll set up a trap here and, I don't know, see if we got a bite.
Song?
Huh?
At the creek. We're this close. God, I could practically smell the stench of his fur like a wet dog at a gas station bathroom. Tonight's the night, Shannon, I know it!
That's really cool. But where's my shoe?
Oh yeah, it's still by the creek. Why don't you go get it so you're not so indecent, and I'm gonna go put my tactical gear on. Alright.
Alright. You could have at least given me your shoe. I know you're gonna wear your tactical shoe anyway.
Our perimeter. Christ, do you have any idea how long that took me to set up?
It's fine. Seriously, it's fine. Look at this. How long are we gonna keep doing this?
Until my dad gets justice.
What if there's nothing to get justice for?
Rodney Evans was a hard-working, upstanding father who deserves justice.
Hugo! Back at your mom's, I found a letter from your dad. He's remarried. He's running a charter fishing company in Maine.
My mom wouldn't hide something like that from me.
Yes, she did!
Well, then where is it?
Ah! Fill in the fire!
Christ, Shannon, you don't have to make up lies if you want to leave, okay?
Oh, my.
I can find Bigfoot on my own.
You're not gonna find Bigfoot. The only hairy asshole in this forest is you!
Nobody's holding you hostage, okay? If you want to leave, you can leave.
I never wanted to be here.
Car's that way.
I want this mic off.
Dennis! Was it him?
Hugo.
Did he do this to you?
Hugo, help me.
Oh, don't worry, honey. I won't let him get away with this. You damn ape!
It's been 2 weeks since Bigfoot enthusiast Hugo Evans went missing during an overnight camping trip.
Get the hell off my property before I call the cops.
Despite multiple searches by authorities, a body has yet to be recovered. While the hunt for Hugo dies, a new search begins. Cryptid hunters now flock to Skagit County, Washington, after multiple Sasquatch reports in the area.
We recently received footage from a woman who claims to have captured the Sasquatch on video.
Honey, look, it's that Bigfoot. Get the shotgun.
Hey, Maria.
Hi. Sorry, I'm simultaneously watching the chat and...
Yeah, I know.
...figure out what's going to happen. Oh, there we are.
Yeah, trying to get people into the room. Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to pretend I don't know that. So I should give a few moments for people to pop in. So while we're waiting, any thoughts? Oh, there's Melissa. Any thoughts about this year's films? I was stoked. No thoughts.
I did a really great job.
That's what I'm talking about. Look at all these people popping up. This is great. Now I should check. Sure. Alumni. See if any alumni are contacting me. Okay. So if you want to let anybody into the Zoom room, if you go to Canvas or look at your email, there should be a message from Canvas that has the Zoom info. Canvas. But you if you're going to be in here, you've got to mute the YouTube channel. Mm-hmm. I made that mistake last year and it was insane before I figured out what was going on. Seems obvious now. So, people keep coming in, so I don't know when to start. Well, maybe I'll just start my initial thoughts and that before we get to the awards. So thank you, everybody who's watching and everybody who's here and mostly everybody who made those films. What an amazing couple of nights of just a lineup of really different films, really different approaches stylistically and narratively, and and so many great documentaries. And anyway, so I'm not telling you anything you don't know, but I was really excited to see the level of quality. And especially, I don't know if you guys knew this, but we had a pandemic and everybody had to make movies in weird ways and we had to teach in weird ways. So it's just an amazing achievement. One of the things that was really cool too was to see alumni in the films, in the credits, having taken on important roles, and then seeing alumni in the chat is so cool. So all you alums who still support the program, thank you so much. Okay. Should I start the awards? Is that enough people? So many people who are getting awards are not yet in here, but that's okay. All right, so let me get my ducks in a row. Okay, so just real quick, before I get to the awards, I want to give a shout out to the faculty. And I have some specific shout outs. Shout out to Justin for overhauling, streamlining our equipment, our resources, fighting for us to get better than we are. He's got more fight in him than I have anymore. So it's very great to have you doing that. Michael Caldwell isn't in here, but I wanted to give a shout out to Michael too, because he's really forward thinking and he really believes positively in what is possible for our students. And he really wants us to Todd Mayatani. That first year was basically commuting between Ellensburg and Utah. But never for a second was any less than totally dedicated, super caring, super committed, you know, to having things be a success and students succeeding. And so super appreciate that. Is Jason Tuholke in here? Yes, good. Jason's here. Jason has to be in two departments, and he's never missed a meeting. He's never missed a group email. He's never missed a retreat. He's super, super committed to film, and he really cares a lot about our students, about our programs. Jason is a mensch. If you're familiar with the term mensch, Jason is a mensch. Assad, I don't know if Assad is in here. Assad Faruqi came on as a first year faculty in the middle of a pandemic, had to create a whole bunch of classes from scratch. I mean, we did our best to help, but, and he was really committed too to making things go well. And I also want to give a shout out to Scott Robinson, our program director. I know a lot of the students, you know, you don't have him for classes, but you should know that he advocates for us. He does all kinds of stuff behind the scenes that without it, our program could not run. Scheduling, budgeting, all kinds of stuff. So, you know, also he puts up with us. And we can be a little bit spicy. I don't know if you guys know that. So anyway, I want to thank all those people. And I want to thank Melissa too, because Melissa had a huge impact on a lot of the folks that are in this program still this year. And so anyway, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. So let's talk about awards. Okay. So I know you're all really sick of PowerPoints. So I'm going to pull up one more PowerPoint for you for the year. Because I don't know, it just feel, wait, I lost my share screen button. There it is. That's weird. Can you see the whole window? No one's talking.
Yeah, we see it.
Okay. Cause on my preview, it only showed half of it. Okay. So, So our awards tonight, we have a mixture of individual awards and film awards. And sorry, I'm trying to still be able to see you while this is happening. And also my notes, oh boy. So we have a mixture of awards, and we kind of, you know, tried to put them in not so much random order, but anyway. Let's just go. And there's a couple special awards. We'll talk about it. So the first award I want to acknowledge is an Outstanding Leadership Award. And that goes to Alex Rapass. And Alex is running the live stream right now. So I apologize if I mispronounced your last name. So Alex came on and served as president of Wildcat Films without having been in Wildcat Films before. He did this amazing job, and then he took on the substantial project of running this live stream and orchestrating everything. And anyway, he's been really amazing. And so there's Alex's certificate. I'm showing these certificates because I went nuts and I started making them and I couldn't stop. So you're going to have to see these. And that's partly why I had to do this PowerPoint. Anyway, so thank you so much, Alex. Amazing job. And could not have gotten through this quarter in Wildcat Films without you. Okay, so here's a film award. And before we get to these, I just want to say, you know, we chose these based on a variety of factors. So it's not necessarily, you know, it's so hard to say, well, this is better than this when you have different genres, different styles, different approaches, but we just want to acknowledge really great achievement in these various films. So, so the first film award, Outstanding Achievement in Corporate Media, goes to the filmmakers who made Sound of Seattle, Easy Street, which was awesome. And that was really fun to see. And I was, shoot, I have the names of the filmmakers on a separate page. Anyway, if you're the filmmakers of these films, wave so that we can officially acknowledge you. Sorry, I have too many windows to try to keep track of. Okay, so great job on that. Music video. This was such a surprise and so much fun to watch, which was Maniac. And sorry, I can't remember who made it, but it was a really fantastic interpretation of that song and that style. Anyway, it was really memorable, and we're very proud of that achievement. Okay, and then documentary. This was a film, we screened it in the winter showcase, and we had tons of really good documentaries this year. And this one we screened in winter, and then I made a point to make sure we screened it again. And that was A Hero's Cry. And I know those filmmakers were Natalie Ray and Emily McDougall, and I don't know if they're in here. Oh yeah, there's Natalie. So we just want to acknowledge the great, great work on that film. Again, many good documentaries, but wanted to acknowledge that one. This is an individual award, outstanding service. Speaking of a person without whom it would be difficult to have gotten the things done that we got done in the last couple of years, you probably know that I'm talking about Derek Boucher, who went above and beyond, that's where he went. So, you know, handling equipment needs, and like, he never, like, we'd ask him to do something. Never for a second did he hesitate. He figured out whatever he needed to figure out. Super reliable. Anyway, so we can't thank Derek enough for the amazing work that he's done. So thank you. That's the outstanding service to this program. Okay. Sound design and mixing. Outstanding achievement. And let's see. Sorry, I forgot who it was. I was going to say something about it, but I can't remember, so I'll just click on it. That's right. Good neighbors. And we generally, you know, let Jason Tuholke, our sound expert, kind of advocate for this film, and he did so in this case, and it sounded great. So really good work. Okay. So one of the things that we do is we choose an outstanding junior. And actually this year we're choosing two. And one of the cool things is that we now have two scholarships that we can give. And I don't know the specific amounts yet, so we'll find that out. But we have two outstanding juniors, and we want to acknowledge them. They will also get a scholarship of some amount. I'm sorry, that's very, vague. But anyway, both of these people, we just really appreciate their contributions to the program. They've really worked really hard. So the first one is Krister, Persson. And you've seen a whole bunch of his fantastic work this year, and also last year too. I remember that. He's also just a great person to work with. So congratulations, and we'll contact you about your scholarship. Outstanding achievement in editing. Very happy to give this award. I was really impressed. And that was the editing in Deprived. And who was that editor? Who, do you know?
Fernando.
Who's that?
Fernando.
I've worked with Fernando before. I knew he was an excellent editor. So anyway, It was great work. It was such an effective, just such effective storytelling choices and rhythmic choices. And anyway, so great job. So outstanding achievement in cinematography. We have two honorable mentions and then another award after that. So because we just had to. So the two honorable mention awards for cinematography go to the directors of photography for Harrow and for Lasting Soul. So Harrow screened tonight, Lasting Soul screened last night. And we just really appreciated their work. Super interesting, beautifully executed, and just great for supporting both of those stories. And then we wanted to give sort of the official Outstanding Achievement in Cinematography Award, and that goes to Good Neighbors, and I believe that was Taylor. Was that Taylor? It really, again, just beautifully done. So, I don't know, so well crafted and so well delivered and so clearly so thoughtful. And anyway, so great job on that. Okay, so our second recipient of the Outstanding Junior Award and who will also get a scholarship, and we want to acknowledge this person, and I'm not sure if they're here, but that is Lucas Olson. And you know, we thank him for his contributions to the program and admire what he's done. And so anyway, thank you, Lucas. Is he here? I don't see him here. Okay. And then achievement in screenwriting. Again, we really have so much appreciation for this. And that was the screenplay for Good Neighbors. You know, a great story, interesting twists and turns, interesting, you know, kind of walking a line between a couple of different genres. So very impressive work, really enjoyable to watch that story unfold. So good job. Outstanding achievement in directing. You know, again, great work that we really wanted to acknowledge, and that was for the directing of Monomania, and that's Alex Groom, right? I'm pointing at you like you can see me, but anyway, great job, Alex. That film I felt was really impactful, very thoughtful directing. I think you got great performances out of your actors. So anyway, good job, and we wanted to acknowledge you for that. Okay, so then this is an honorable mention award for achievement in drama, and 100% we needed to acknowledge this film, and that again was Lasting Soul, that screened last night. It was a really impressive, very powerful story, very, you know, a lot of memorable images and memorable moments. And so again, we're so proud of that achievement. And I think that's Lucas Olson. Is that right? Somebody nod or make me feel like I'm right. I might be right. Anyway, it was very, very good work and really great to watch. So nice work. And then the outstanding achievement in drama goes to Good Neighbors. And, you know, on all of these, I want to acknowledge all of the team members, because one of the things that was really cool as I was looking at the Production 6 films, you know, on the sheet for the showcase, and on the Production 6, so many of the films made in Production 3 only have like one person or two people, especially because of the pandemic. And then it was cool to see on the Production 6 films, you know, films where it was really one person got to really take care of one department, and, you know, which is usually how it works in the real world. So anyway, I was just, you know, on all of those films was impressed about the collaboration that had to happen in order to make, you know, in order to achieve those successful films. So wanted to acknowledge Good Neighbors. and outstanding achievement in comedy. You might already know what this is. Absolutely deserving of this award, and that is Squatch Man. Yes. You know, we at least every couple of years we have some kind of Sasquatch movie. So I'm always relieved when one comes around because I'm like, oh, good. Like, we don't want to lose our grip on that as a culture. As a, you know, different take from what I've seen before. Again, with like the style, the kind of documentary or mockumentary style, really so well executed, really good performances from all those folks. So a great, great job to everybody who worked on that film. Okay. So, outstanding senior. This is where I start crying because that's how this works every year. Both of the people that are getting these awards represent, we have many fantastic and wonderful students, but we have to pick some because that's how it works. Both of these students really represent what I think is, what we try to help students find in themselves and what we want out of our program. So when we think about who is outstanding, we think about work ethic, we think about reliability, technical skill is part of it, but to me, what's so much more than that is levels of commitment and commitment to artistry and being a person that you want to collaborate with over and over. So, and I, both of these people I would put in that category. So the first one I want to acknowledge is Taylor Amble. So I think any of you who have worked with Taylor would agree that she's quite outstanding. So, and then the second outstanding senior has already been mentioned tonight, but he will be mentioned again, Derek Boucher. Derek and Taylor, they're not just a package deal. they are each incredibly outstanding filmmakers and people and contributors to our program. And we're so happy that you spent these years with us. Sorry. Ooh, okay. So, and that goes for everybody. We're so happy that you to the seniors, that you spent your time and energy in our program. And we know this last year, spring quarter of the previous year, and then this whole year, like, brought out to some degree the best and the worst in all of us, because we were stressed. We didn't know what was going to happen. We were anxious. We had to do things a different way. And you guys just rose to the challenge in ways that we really appreciate. And, like Justin has talked about the Production 6 students. Justin, do you want to say anything about that class?
Yeah, I mean, they've all heard me say it before, but I really have been impressed with the commitment and the quality of work that this class has done. I've pushed them very, very hard throughout advanced pre-production and production, and they continued to just give it their best the whole way through. Mm-hmm. It was really wonderful to see the films all come together so well.
Yep, they are really something. And we have an amazing crop of juniors coming up that I'm so excited to see what they continue to produce in the program. And we're really, really proud of everybody. I feel like I can say that on behalf of the whole faculty. So there you go. Congratulations, special congratulations to the class of 2021. We love you. And we want you to continue to do great things. And ask us for those letters of recommendation. We are always happy to write them. And we're just really proud. So thank you for the films that we were able to watch and the time that we were able to spend with you this year. That's all I have. Any thoughts from anybody?
Yeah, like Todd said, thank you, Maria.
Oh, you're welcome. You know.
Yeah, thank you, Maria, for putting this together. You know, it's a lot of work, and it's great that we have you doing this because you do it very nicely. Thank you.
Oh, you're very welcome. Thank you. It's my honor to do so. And one more thank you to Alex for running this live stream. I mean, it is not easy. Derek knows. There's so many things to just keep track of and making sure things are in order and dealing with the technical things that happen. So it's really just, and Alex has been so positive. That's been one of the most fantastic things about working with him is his positivity. Even when I was like, oh my gosh, what's going to happen? Alex was just super positive, hardworking. And yeah, so thank you for that. Well, are we going to the tab or what? Melissa, you're going to need to drive down. I'm sorry. Can you get there before closing?
Yeah, I'll be there in like 3 hours.
Great.
Save a gin and tonic for me.
I will. I didn't even notice the chat. Oh, so many nice things. You all are amazing. Okay. Well, should we sign off? I guess we can let's end the live stream and then let's chat for a minute in the Zoom. So